And it's the season of God's favor.
Amen.
Amen. It's the season of God's favor. How many of us truly believe that?
Hallelujah.
It's the season of God's favor, right? When we accept that, right, we must be willing to move forward, right?
Amen.
In this new season, many of us are coming off the fast, right? And I love the fast at the beginning of the year because the year before, our year gets so clouded with nonsense, right? It's so full of stuff that kind of take our focus off of God.
Amen.
So I truly believe a fast puts us back on track, right, to fulfill God's purpose, the purpose that He's given us, right?
Amen.
I look at that fast as realignment for our assignment.
Amen.
So I think it's awesome. It's realignment for our assignment. So now we all should be refocused back on the purpose and the assignment that God has given us, the God that God has put us here. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So in that season, in the season of God's favor, right, there must be some type of transformation. Right? There must be some type of transformation. So now we come off this fast. We come off the fast. We feel good. We feel energized. We feel more focused on God. So it has to be some type of transformation in our lives. It's different from change, right? The Bible says, So Romans 12, 2, right? Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world. Let God transform you into a newer person by changing what you think.
Mm-hmm.
Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good, pleasing, and perfect. Right? So there must be some type of transformation. It's different from change, right? I can change my shoes, I can change my pants, I can change my shirt, but I'm still the same person.
Yes.
When we transform, we no longer do the same things we used to do.
We used to do.
We no longer believe the same things we used to believe. We no longer act the same way we used to act. So transformation changes everything. Transformation creates a cut across everything that currently exists in order to make it better or replace it all together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Amen. Amen.
So it creates a cut. Transformation creates a cut. Although, I'm just showing my Instagram sometime, right? And I'm saying, like, I follow some makeup artists, right? And they just posting pictures like when they make women up and they got a before and after picture. Sometimes the after picture, like nothing like the before. So I'm like, dang, that's the transformation right there. Because they look nothing like the before picture. So that's a different type of transformation. But there must be some type of transformation in our lives. And this present, like I said, it's a cut across everything. Nothing stays the same when transformation is present.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
So transformation creates a shift. It creates a shift. Transformation forces us to be different, forces us to move forward. Amen? Some of us hate change. We hate change, right? We're creatures of habit. I'm like that. My wife will tell you, when I wake up in the morning, there's certain things I have to do and my day feels out of whack. When I come home, there's certain things I have to do or I feel out of whack. Right? So we're creatures of habit. We hate change. And I'm here to tell you people, God, if we stay that way, we will die. If we stay that way, we don't like change, we will die.
Amen.
At least I know if I die, I'm going to die moving forward.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm
going
to die moving forward.
Yes.
We hate change, but it's in us, right? It's an innate characteristic in us. We hate change. Right? So when God transforms us, He's steadily trying to transform us. When He transforms us, He does two things. The first thing He does, He addresses our issues.
Yes.
Right? He uses our problems, our issues, to our benefit.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
Many of us, we're stuck because we feel like we have an inability that's prohibiting us from moving forward in God.
Mm-hmm.
So the first thing He does, He addresses our issues. Right? He uses our issues to our benefit, our issues to our advantage.
Amen.
Right? Look at Moses. God said, Moses, go to Pharaoh, let my people go. Right? The first thing Moses did, he said, God, I can't. Right? For those who don't know, he couldn't communicate effectively. So the first thing he did, he thought about his inability and said, God, I can't do it. Send my brother Aaron. Send somebody else. I can't do it. But God is trying to use you in spite of your inability to show His greater ability.
Amen.
Amen. God is saying, forget about what you can't do and focus on what I can do. God is trying to use you in spite of you. Take it there. God is trying to use you in spite of you. He's trying to use us in spite of us. Sometimes we get in the way of God. We get in the way of our own the ability to move forward in God.
Amen.
We get in the way. It's not so much the enemy all the time. Not
come
so
on, man. Come on.
It's us.
That's right.
So when we realize that, we have to be willing to let God use us in spite of that inability.
Right.
In spite of the things that we think we can't do.
Mm-hmm.
All right? The second thing He does, He empowers us by letting us know who we are in Him.
Amen.
In God, we're free, right?
Yeah.
We're wise. We're overcomers, right?
Yeah.
We're great. We're awesome. So He lets us know who we are in Him.
Yeah.
And the only way He does that is through His word.
Amen.
Like, He's speaking to us.
Mm-hmm.
When we know who we are, we can then walk in it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, nobody, when someone tells me what I am for so long, I then begin to become what they say I am.
Uh-huh.
Right? The world may tell you this or that, but you're not that. The longer you tell somebody what they are, they'll start to become that over a while.
Amen.
Right? That's why we gotta stay on our word. Amen. Right? Listen to what God's saying that we are. Because over time we'll start to become what God's saying that we are.
Amen.
And we'll start to become, look at LeBron James, right? He's arguably the greatest basketball player ever. Arguably, right? Now when he first came into the league, he wasn't all that good. Right? He wasn't great, excuse me. He was good, but he wasn't great. Right? But over time, what happened? Right? With practice and learning different things and all the different things he went through, he's now the greatest, right? So people tell him he's the greatest. So now he walks in it. Right? His speech is different. His game is different, right? The way he interviews is different. Like the way he carries himself is different. So when people tell him that he's the greatest, he believes us. Now he walks like he's the greatest.
Yes.
He believes he's the greatest.
Uh-huh.
Right? While people tell him, y'all good? Y'all still me, right? So with knowing that, when people tell him that, he can believe it, right? When I believe what I am, when I know what I am, I can start to walk in it.
Amen.
I can posture myself towards that which they said I am.
Yes.
People said I am, yes. To which God said that I am. Right? If I'm great, I know I'm great, I can posture myself towards greatness, right? Towards greater. Amen?
Amen.
So God does those two things when he's trying to transform us. He addresses our issues first, and afterwards he empowers us by letting us know who we are in him.
Amen.
Yeah, but we have to be careful, right? Because the enemy is always lurking.
Always.
The enemy is always lurking. Anytime the enemy does something to you or in your life, it's because God already did something good. So he's responding to a God move. He's responding to something good that God has already did in your life.
Uh-huh.
The devil never initiates anything, right? He never initiates anything. He's always a response to a God move.
Uh-huh.
Always a response to a God move, right? For example, it's like chess. Right? I'm not that good of a chess player, but I know Brother Darnell is. Right? Brother Bishop thinks he's good. He's all right. He didn't need it. He's all right. But correct me if I'm wrong, Brother Darnell. When you're playing chess, right? You gotta think, you're not only thinking about your next move, but you're thinking about your opponent's next move.
Yes.
And how they're going to respond to the move you just made. And so forth and so on. So you always have to be 10 steps ahead of your opponent. Right? So that's how God is. He's always 100 steps ahead of the devil. Because you know, every move he makes, the devil's going to respond to it. It's something else he has.
Amen.
To the devil, he always responds to a God move.
Amen.
He never initiates anything, right? Some of y'all say they're quiet right now, but y'all need to be praising God that you're worth the attack, right?
Oh.
You pray God that you're worth the attack. If the devil's not what you're worth every single day, something's wrong. If he ain't come at you every single moment and think of that, you can start thinking, wait, something's wrong, right? It's a saying out there, right? If you don't have haters, you're doing something wrong.
Uh-huh.
You got haters, you must be doing something wrong. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Every single second of your day, you're doing something wrong.
Come on.
You're doing something wrong. He always responds to a God attack. Or he always responds to a God move.
That's right.
The devil never initiates anything. Never initiates anything, man. Right? The Bible says in John 10:10, right? The thief's purpose is to steal, kill, and destroy. Right? My purpose is to give them a rich and satisfying life. Right? So the enemy, God's trying to warn us right here that the enemy does three things. He's coming to steal, kill, and destroy. He's trying to take something from you, right? Steal, the first one.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning we have something of value. You think of a robber or someone who steals, a klepto, right? They don't take anything that's not of value. So why would I take something that I can't flip and get money for? And then why would I take something that I can't sell on the back end, right? So he's trying to take something from you because we have something of value. Amen? We have something of value, so the devil's trying to steal that from us, right? He's trying to steal the people's ability to seek the truth and see the truth. And the only way we defend against that is by standing in the word and knowing God's voice.
Amen.
And following God, right? The second thing, he's trying to kill. Meaning he's trying to take your life, right? Your life is established first. The devil's trying to take your life. He's trying to take your life. We got to protect. We got to know. When we know what the things he's trying to do, we can guard against that.
Amen.
He's trying to take your life. He knows if he takes your life, the kingdom of God is now affected.
That's right. Uh-huh.
So the kingdom of God is now hindered because he's took your life already.
Yes.
All right. The last thing he's trying to do, he's trying to destroy. Meaning something has been built. Right.
Uh-huh.
The testimony.
Right.
The Bible. Our faith. Right. Your home. Your family. He's trying to destroy those things.
Yes.
So we have to stay in guard and be aware of that, man.
Yes.
And y'all sitting there kind of quiet right now. Y'all, I'm about to
get on your chest.
We gotta remember something, right? Lucifer messed up once and was kicked out of heaven for good. He messed up every single day. God never got.
Amen. That's the truth.
So why wouldn't he mess with you every single day? Right? Wow. He hit on you. Right? We get all the chances he never got.
Wow. Amen.
He's supposed to hit on you. He ain't hit on you, it's something wrong.
All right.
Yeah. If that one ain't messing with you, it's something wrong.
Amen.
It's something wrong.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Every day, man, we need to be praising God because we work the attack.
Right?
We need to be praising God because we work the attack. One of my favorite scriptures in the Bible is Jeremiah 29:11.
Uh-huh.
Which says what?
I know.
God's coming to Israel up.
I know the plan.
I know the plans that I have.
Can I have you, right?
Yeah.
Plans good. Can I have you, right? He's coming to Israel with all these things, right? He's coming to Israel with all the plans he had before him. But so many people negate the verse before.
Yeah.
Verse 10. When he's telling Israel that you're going to be in exile in Babylon 7 years.
7 years.
You're going to be in Babylon in exile 7 years. So it's a process you got to get through. You got to get through.
Yes.
For it to be fulfilled. I already promised you.
Four.
And then God is the promise, the process, the promise. You can hashtag that if you want. The promise, the process, the promise. Okay? So God makes a promise. He's making a promise to Israel right now. He's telling you it's a process you got to go through. Some of us are in that middle phase right now, that process stage, and you're thinking about giving up, but I'm telling you, don't give up.
Come on.
The process is closer. Remember that. So he made a promise to Israel.
That's right.
That I'm going to do all these things for you. But I'm not going to do these things until you serve, you be in exile in Babylon for 70 years.
Wow.
70 years. Right? He said, then after you serve, then I'll come. And I'll do everything that I promise.
Thank you, Jesus. My God.
Then I'll do everything I promise, right? So it's a process in order to get to God's promise. You got to remember that. Most of us want the promise without no work. Without the process. We gotta think about the process that comes after the promise. We know God made us a ton of promises in His Word.
That's right.
Right? But we gotta remember it's a process in order to get to that promise.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Amen.
Like I said earlier, you know, like Bishop said, it's the year of God's favor. Man, how many of us truly believe that?
Yes.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
When Bishop declared that, it's like I'm expecting something.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. As long as I know what I do, whatever I gotta do, I'm expecting something.
That's right.
If I get it, for me, that's cool.
Yes, sir. That's right.
So I'm good with that.
She
get it, I'm good with that.
Hello.
I get it.
Hello.
If Bishop get it, I hope I can get it too. I'm just gonna go. So I'm expecting something, man. It's the year of God's favor, man. I decree to cut that every single morning. The bishop said that, man.
Uh-huh.
I decree, man, Lord, this is your, let your favor follow us this day.
Yes.
Every day I wake up, man, or wife, let your favor follow us.
Yes.
Every single morning, I'm decreeing and I'm declaring that, man. I'm excited. Now, what do you think this is going to be the year of God's
favor? This is
favor?
It.
This is our lives, man. It's the year of God's favor.
Amen.
Amen. Hear God's favor, man.
Me too.
How do you receive God's favor? It comes from serving well.
Uh-huh.
Serving well. John 13:35 says, by this, all men will know that you are my disciples. So many of us need to learn to serve when our faith is not based on a guaranteed outcome.
Uh-huh.
Some of us only serve when we know we're getting something in return.
Come on, come on.
Some of us need to learn to serve when we know our faith is not based on that guaranteed outcome.
Right.
We're not expecting nothing in particular.
Come on.
Right? So we need to learn to serve. Faithfully, right? Serve well.
Yeah.
Wow.
God's trying to do great things in His people.
Amen.
He's trying to do great things in every single one of us. He's trying to create a miracle in your life.
Amen.
And don't think because He creates a miracle once and then time passes that the miracle is no longer a miracle.
Uh-huh.
God creates a miracle in your life, there's always a miracle.
It's always a miracle.
And when you have a baby, well, that's a miracle when it first comes out. Over a year, we start to forget about that miracle, right?
Uh-huh.
And the older, they start getting on our nerves.
Come
right?
on.
Like a pain in the butt.
Come on.
And over time, we think that that's not a miracle, but the miracle is still a miracle.
That's right.
No matter how much time passes, God is trying to do something great in every single one of us. Young people.
Oh, yeah.
God is trying to do something.